from that information, just from the history alone, the thinking process starts. So he's asking, now he's asking you, not the specifics, but maybe some differentials, and you begin to prioritize and put probabilities next to it. Most likely, least likely, somewhat likely. So we narrow down some differentials. So what do you think, based on that, would be your diagnosis? Or diagnoses, your differentials? Don't know?
A suggest?
Anyone have any ideas?
MS.
Okay, anyone else? Any lab tests that we possibly might run?
See what we do in clinic? Go ahead.
Okay, so I'll go through a list of what I think it is. So, as you can see, we have a bunch of differential diagnoses. Multiple system atrophy, normal pressure on hydrocephalus, olfactory dysfunction, oligopontus, cerebellar atrophy, post-traumatic brain injury, progressive tubular nuclear palsy, subdural hematoma, and Wilson's disease, and the list continues on. Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, basal tumor, benign essential tremor, cerebrovascular disease, cortical basal degeneration, Jacob's disease, dementia with Lewy bodies, drug-induced tremor, and metabolic causes. Okay, so these are the motor symptoms seen with this specific disease. So this should kind of clue you guys in as to what, narrow down our diagnosis. So the cardinal motor features seen with this is bradykinesia, which occurs in 80 to 90% of the patients, which involves slowness of movements, decreased amplitudes of movements, and the second thing is rigidity. It occurs in 80 to 90% of the patients, resistance to passive movements in both flexors and extensor muscles, and it's often accompanied by the cogwheel phenomenon, which should be a clear indicator of something. The third one is tremor at rest. The common initial symptoms are 70 to 90 of the patients have this, often resolves with action or during sleep, prominently involves the distal extremity in the hands, and may involve the jaw, the tongue, the lip, the chin, or the legs. And the last one is postural instability, which is predisposes the patient to falls and injury, occurs later stages of the disease, and results from a postural reflex. So symptoms with this disease that are non-motor are constipation, orthostatic hypotension, sweating, urinary retention, anxiety, depression, and fatigue, and hand disorder, olfactory dysfunction, insomnia, rapid eye movement disorder, restless syndrome, and sleep apnea. So this case that I'm going to present right now is actually the patient presented to the UB clinic. We have a 69-year-old retired medical technician referred by the UB Dental Department presenting for low back pain. He states that the pain started after he lifted a box which was filled with water bottles. He's been treated by a private chiropractor for about a month. The previous chiropractor did stem and adjustment, which reduced his low back pain. He decided to come to UB Chiro to continue his treatment on his low back. He rates his pain a 6 out of 10, which is localized to the right PSIS. The patient states that a perforated colon is his 10 out of 10, and he describes the pain as achy. The patient stated that he had chronic to mild low back pain for a long time, but not as bad. It's not as bad as this pain that he first presented. He denies any history of nausea, vomiting, double vision, blurry vision, tinnitus, dizziness, histrionotropia, dizziness, drop tacks, and stretching and hot pack reduces the pain, and prolonged sitting and standing increases the pain. He's an EMT and he volunteers his spare time to help his community. He's happily married and exercises every single day. His previous surgeries were all successful. He denies any history of smoking, alcohol, recreational drugs, and no history of physical abuse. His past medical history is pretty extensive. As you can see, he had a heart bypass, bilateral indirect hernias, he had his tonsils removed, he had his gallbladder removed, and he's currently on medication for cholesterol and his heart. Review of systems, his general systems, the patient does not have any stress or any complaints. The only thing that bothers him is loss of smell, and he can't eat a large meal after his colon surgery. He can't smell certain things, which has been going on for the past 9 or 8 months. He's a diabetic and medically treated. He's on a strict nutrition plan, and his current sugar level is under control. The patient denies any musculoskeletal, neurological symptoms, cardiovascular, respiratory symptoms, urinary symptoms, or digestive symptoms. His vitals are all listed there. His height is 68 inches, 0.35 is his weight, BMI 22.5. His blood pressure on his left arm is 105 or 60. His pulse is 70 beats per minute. His respiration is 12 breaths per cycle, and his temperature was 96.4. So general exam. The patient is alert and oriented and doesn't appear to be in pain. The patient appears to be in a good mood, and the patient's gait is normal, and no shuffling or tremors are noted. His postural is Slightly forward head coverage and rounding the shoulders, right shoulder slightly inferior, and hypolordosis is noted. His neuro exam. Sharp adult testing, upper extremity shoulder pathologies, muscle strength grading is 5x5 bilaterally in the upper extremity. Patient's biceps, brachioradialis, and triceps tendons, reflexes are all 2+ bilaterally. Cerebellar testing, hand gait, heel and toe walk all show no gross abnormalities, and Robert's test revealed no abnormalities. His ortho test. Lazarus protocol reproduces pain at the right SI joint, and it was positive for 3 out of 5 tests. While Salvin does not produce pain, SLR and CAMPS do not reproduce pain. The range of motion. His lumbar active range of motion and passive motion was restricted in flexion with hamstring tightness. His hip active range of motion and passive range of motion produced tightness and stiffness in all directions. His chiro exam. Hypertonicity and tenderness was noted at the iliolumbar ligament. His hypotonicity of the glute max and hamstrings are also noted, and joint provocation revealed a restriction at the right PSIS. So initial diagnosis was an acute flare-up of a chronic condition with associated hypertonic paraspinal muscles due to somatic segmental dysfunction of the sacrum, and as well as myofascial pain syndrome due to somatic segmental dysfunction of the sacrum. So, the treatment. HVLA grade 5, adjusted to the right PSIS. He returned 4 days later. The patient stated that his pain initially increased the first few days over the weekend, then subsided. Patient returned the following week and rated his pain at a 3 out of 10 compared to a 6 when he first came in. After 7 visits, the patient's low back resolved, and the patient now comes in weekly for wellness care. So these are risk factors associated with the disease. Obviously, I haven't told you what the disease is yet, but you guys should have a kind of direction as to where the disease is, kind of where I'm thinking of this presentation. So elevated cholesterol, head trauma, high caloric intake, inflammation associated with microglia, mitochondrial dysfunction, oxidative stress, just to name a few, are some of these risk factors associated with this disease. The gene factors associated with this disease is the SCNA gene is usually found at the tips of nerve cells and presynaptic transmitters, and the GBA gene is found in lysosomes. The LLRK2 gene makes dardrin, which is responsible in protein brain tissues, and the PTEN is responsible for mitochondria. The SOD2 gene is transfers superoxidized into hydrogen peroxidized, which is a less toxic form to protect against cell death. And the VPS35 is responsible for retrograde transportation of proteins. So, final diagnosis. We know that our patient has low back pain. What if the patient presented with low back pain in addition to these findings? Asymmetric resting tremor in the upper extremity. During gait, the affected arm does not swing fully, and the affected foot scrapes the floor. The patient also has the following: bradykinesia, rigidity, and postural instability. 3 out of 4 symptoms is required to make a clinical diagnosis. Imaging is not needed for a typical presentation. However, imaging can be used in a case where there's no tremor, but would be only useful to rule out a disease such as a brain lesion or a stroke or a tumor. Usually, the fourth symptom is seen after the 8-year mark of the disease. So we all know he was previously diagnosed with the condition, and that condition is, anyone care to take a guess on what that condition is?
After would it take part 4? Get it? Was it? Somebody took part 4?
Excellent. Now, that's correct. What I'm going to say is, Andrew, I'm going to introduce Andrew. Andrew's my patient here. He's going to kind of talk about his management, about Parkinson's, and what he does, and everything that he's doing to
Thank
combat.
You. Good afternoon. So my name is Andy, and I have Parkinson's disease, and I'm here to tell you about my journey in fighting this disease and making you aware of the different stages of this disease so that if you have a patient that presents these symptoms, it'll make it easier for you to diagnose them. And I'll answer any questions as best I can at the end. Sometimes with my disease, my voice starts to fade. So if it does, those up in the upper tiers, just give me a wave to give me a heads up. Thank you. Okay, here we go. Andy, you have Parkinson's disease. 5 words that I will never forget from my neurologist, who I will call Dr. J, back in June of 2014 when I was 67 years old. I had been an emergency medical technician for almost 3 decades, and over the past year noticed some slight tremors in my right hand and felt my balance was slightly off. I just thought it was part of getting old. Then one of my friends mentioned my printing was getting very, very small, as was my writing, and I remember reading an article on Michael J. Fox, the actor who has Parkinson's, and this was his first symptom. For the most part, I was in good health. I exercise every day, I ate right, I've maintained my weight since high school. I haven't gained any weight, that's 55 years ago when I graduated. And all I knew about Parkinson's was that it slowly damaged the central nervous system because the brain's dopamine cells start to die off. I then made an appointment with Dr. J, who ran a slew of tests on me. He's not only a neurologist, but a movement disorder specialist. At the office, he performed many tests, CAT scans, and he finally sat me down and he said, "Andy, you definitely have Parkinson's disease." I became quiet and he said to me, "What are you thinking of?" And with confidence, I looked up at him and said, "You know, we're gonna be both famous someday because I will be the first patient with exercise and positive thinking to beat this disease." He smiled and shook his head, and I looked at him and said, "You could always say you misdiagnosed me." And I left with a prescription for Azilect, which I still take today. I knew from day one that I had to come up with a creative plan as my future depended on it. I had been a gymnast in high school, so the first thing I did was to build a 18-foot long by 2-inch wide balance beam in my basement, which I walk on religiously every morning for 30 minutes. I stand on one leg every morning. One of the things I do is just for coordination, 4-3-2-1, 1-2-3-4. And I also stand on my head. I probably need a kick in my head for doing this, but I do it every day. I find the blood. I'm not leaning up against anything, I'm just standing there. I like the feeling of the blood flowing through my head. It's very therapeutic. I do daily exercises such as, for cognitive, I do word search. The electronic game called Simon. I don't know if anybody knows what that is. 4 colors pop up electronically and you have to follow that. I also go to what's called a Rocksteady boxing class 3 times a week. It's specifically designed for Parkinson's patients. There's about 20 of us in the class, 1/3 of women. And I also come here for an alignment, just to keep my body in line. After the first year, I was doing so well that I said, you know, maybe I wasn't misdiagnosed. So I stopped my medications only to have the symptoms come back quickly and in an unbelievable manner. I went right back on the meds. I told my doctor, and he was quite upset and said, "Don't ever do that again." And of course, I won't. I'm still in the first stage of Parkinson's disease. And yes, several times a month, my right hand does have tremors. But when this does happen, I just say to myself, "Andy, picture yourself at an amusement park and enjoy the ride." And it makes it much easier that way. I pass this along to some of my other parkies at my class who get very upset when they shake. And it's just part of the disease. Over the years, I found that things that I once took for granted are now precious to me. In the spring, you know, watching the flowers bloom, in the summer, sitting on the beach and just watching the sun rays bounce along the water. In the fall, just standing outside and letting the leaves fall upon my face. When I first started doing this, my wife called the doctor and said, "Something wrong with this guy." But even in the, you know, so too in the winter, when the snow comes down, I go outside and just stand there like this. I mean, I really appreciate life much better. And I have noticed over the years that my sense of taste and smell has diminished. The only thing I could taste is lemon lime marinara sauce and chocolate, thank God. So I can't smell anything. I volunteer at a short stay at St. Vincent's, and I cook for people, and I like to talk and say a muffin gets stuck in the toaster. You know, everybody comes running in saying, you know, can't you smell that? And I go, no. I said, you know, all the proof is that the fire alarm doesn't work. But anyhow, in the scheme of things, I really feel fine. I have a great wife, Jean. She's very supportive. I have a great support group of family and friends. I intend to be a centenarian. I'm still in the first stage. But I thought I would go into the five stages briefly and talk to you about that in case the patient comes in and give you a better understanding. So many of the people in my Parkinson's class, it was years before I was diagnosed. I think the youngest one is about 58, the oldest is 80. And most of the time the doctors would tell them, well, you're just getting old, until finally, you know, somebody says, you gotta see a neurologist, who just picked it up instantly. In stage one, the initial stage, people have mild tremors. Sometimes there's difficulty in their posture. Some facial expressions called the Parkinson's stare. You know, you may walk in on them, they jump, because they're just staring and thinking. But for the most part, everybody lives alone. They don't really need any help. Stage two, the disease starts getting worse. You have bilateral tremors on both sides of your body. Walking becomes a little more difficult, but you still can live alone. Stage three, which is the mid-stage, this is where the problems start to happen. Your loss of balance increases. You walk very slow. It's called like a Parkinson's shuffle. You really can't get your feet up. Some patients have what's called frozen foot. They're just standing there, and suddenly as if somebody grabs their feet and they can't move. It only lasts a few minutes, but those that I've spoken to, when it first happened to them, they were in a panic. Literally in a panic, it was like a magnet. And finally it just lets go, and it may never happen again for years. And most of these people in stage three, people have to come in and sometimes help them dress, get dressed. Stage four, symptoms are very severe and limiting. Most individuals need to use a walker to get around. Assistance has to be required. And the activities of daily living are almost nil. They have to have somebody to help them. Stage five is really the end game. Stiffness of the legs makes it impossible to stand or walk. People are basically bedridden. Sometimes if they have to go to a doctor, they have to be put in a wheelchair. At this point, most of them are experiencing hallucinations and delusions. Not that it can't happen once in a while in the early stages, but mostly in the fifth stage. I mean, I've seen it. It's, you know, the thought of even being in that position makes me work even harder to beat this disease. I actually spend 90 minutes a day between the walking and the exercises because my life depends on it. You know, Parkinson's is what I have. It's not who I am. The greatest challenge that Parkinson's patients face are two things. One, making sure the Parkinson's train doesn't run over them and just beating it. Excuse me. And the second thing is the lack of knowledge of the public. You know, many times someone will say, if I go into a doctor's office, I'm filling out a form, and the secretary will say, well, you have Parkinson's disease, how come you're not shaking? And I go, not everybody shakes, but you know, that's just the conception of a Parkinson's patient. And one more thing, this year, 60,000 Americans will be diagnosed with Parkinson's. 4% will be under the age of 50. 15% will have a family history of Parkinson's, but the jury is still out. whether it's hereditary or not. Anyhow, that's basically it, in a nutshell. I thank you for letting me visit with you and taking up your time and telling you my story. And while I'm not a neurologist, if there's any questions I can answer, please ask. Anybody? Anything? Yes?
What would you say is the exercise or activity you do on a daily basis that helps your symptoms?
Okay, so I start off in the morning, I get up. Excuse me one second. The first thing I do, my stretching exercises. Then I go downstairs and I walk on my balance beam listening to the radio. Then I stand on one leg. I do my puzzles. I do my Simon game, which I really like. And then I go outside and I walk, whether it's freezing, snowing, raining, I walk those 2 miles. 3 days a week, I go to my rock steady. I go to my rock steady boxing class. The first 20 minutes are stretching exercise. The next 20 minutes we do cognitive skills and balance. For example, we'll walk around, we'll put our hands behind our back, pretend we're ice skating, go around the gym backwards, just to get better perception and balance. We have a game with cards, we have giant cards, 52 in a deck. Say we start off at 20, red is minus, black is plus, picture cards are 10. So we start off at 20, and he'll pick, say, the three of clubs. Now we're up to 23. Next card is the queen of diamonds. Now we're down to 13. And we'll go around, and we'll do it quicker and quicker. We'll do it 3 times. And at the end, we'll say, who knows the answer? And, most of us know it. We'll also do what's called a fireman ladder. It's like a rope. You put it on the floor, and we jump in and out of it, back and forth. We have a wall, it's about the size of this desk, half ball, rubber wall. We jump with it and try to balance. And one of the things which is a lot of fun, we'll go into the boxing gym, four of us, and diagonally, like say me and my partner Claire, we'll throw a ball high, the other people that diagonally will throw it low, and we'll go fast, as fast as we can. Until somebody hits the ball or the ball drops, and then 4 more people come in. The last 20 minutes is boxing. Sometimes we box together, we put on different gloves, and we punch each other's hand. Sometimes we do what's called a memory round. The instructor will say, okay, for the first 3 punches, we're gonna do, jabs, punches, uppercuts, or with a hand back. If he says it's even or odd, odd hits are on the right side, left side. And we'll do that, and we speed it up. Before, the end of the day, I can honestly say I never perspired since high school like I perspired there. Now, not everybody can keep up the pace. If they can't, they just stop and rest. Nobody expects anybody to do anything. And some people do eventually fall by the wayside. But those that are good candidates, for example, we had this fellow Mike who came in 6 months ago. He had to be driven there. Big, big man, had a cane. Now he drives himself. You give him a basketball and he will bounce that ball like to the wall and back while we cheer him on. It's amazing how it could help this park, this rock steady boxing. But again, people come and go. Afterwards, we sit around and we talk. Nobody else is in the gym at that time. I go to Title Boxing in Milford. It's on Cherry Street near Bob Sports. And we'll talk. Like somebody will say recently, I'm starting to have problems swallowing. And someone else will say, would you rather be on a feeding tube? You know, think of that. Or, you know, someone will say, I'm getting very nervous that my hands are starting to shake, and I'll tell them what I do. I say, pretend you're on a ride. You know, it'll be fine. And we're very supportive, and it's, sometimes it's overwhelming to see approximately 20 people really fighting for their life and trying so, so hard, you know, to beat this disease. It's, you know, many times when we're working out, people looking in from the window outside saying, what are these people doing? But it's quite a group. You know, we're in it together. You know, I volunteered years ago for 25 years at the EMS in Trumbull, and you know, it was good camaraderie. I volunteered last 7 years at the hospital with the nurses, and it's really nice camaraderie, but this is different. I mean, you know, you can call each other at 3 o'clock in the morning and talk to each other. Because many times, even the spouses, you know, even though I have a supportive wife, you know, when someone says, I know how you feel, but doesn't have Parkinson's, they really don't know how I feel. You know, inside I could be agonizing that day, and I just don't show it. But someone else had a question?
It seems like you've been able to maintain such a high level of positivity in your life in the face of a very difficult diagnosis. You talked a little bit about how, like, your groups, you know, family and friends surrounding you have supported you during a tough time.
Right.
What have you done for yourself personally to maintain such a positive attitude?
I've always been that way. I don't know why. You know, my father was that way and my aunts were that way. But, you know, even when I was young, you know, when I was bar mitzvah, my father said to me, you know, Andrew, for every minute you're upset, that's a minute of happiness you can never get back in your life. And believe it or not, I remember it, you know. But I just realized working on an ambulance as an EMT, working at the hospital, seeing these other patients, I realized how lucky I am compared to other people who are just terrible, terrible, shaped with terrible diseases, and it just gives me more motivation. You know, it's just my personality, and I try to pass it along to people I know. But it's true, but it's very hard to do. But I really can say I never really get down. Anybody?
Are you taking any, are you doing a nutritional supplement regimen or?
No, what I do is, I mean, I've never really eaten, I never liked meat even as a child. I didn't even know what a vegetarian was back then. You know, I just didn't like to chew, but I, besides the medication I take you know, vitamin B, I take vitamin D, I take milk thistle, which is supposed to be good for the liver. I take niacin, which is good for the cholesterol. My cholesterol sometimes gets below 100. My triglycerides sometimes get down to 22. Excuse me. And my doctors will say, go out and eat some junk. It's just too low. But I do take just the basic vitamins. I don't go to a health food store and load myself up and stuff. You know, I try to keep my body cleansed, basically. And does that answer your question?
Yes.
Does anybody else have any questions?
You know, Andrew does stay active. You told him he stays active. Andrew, what was the last injury you just had?
Oh, my finger. I heard it boxing.
He broke his finger.
You know, no, I took it off today because I didn't want to be coming in with the thing. But, you know, normally when you box, you hit the bag, and the bag is on a chain and swings. But this time, somebody came by after a year and said, why don't I hold that bag for you? And when I hit that bag, just to relieve any stress, I really hit it. I tried to punch right through the bag. And I hit that bag, and I must have turned my hand, and it was just like hitting a piece of steel. Down I went, you know. We had x-rays, and Then, just as I was starting to feel a little bit better from the laser treatment, what do? You know, the little boy in me, there was these steps, these concrete steps. So what do? Instead of walking up the steps, I run, and I said, let me try doing them, try two at a time. And I fell forward right on the splint, and that splint did everything. So that'll take about 2 months probably to heal. But I try to think young. My great nieces, when they and regular nieces, when they ask me a question about life or what they should do, I go, you're asking the wrong guy. Even though I'm 72, I should know these things, but I don't. I just tell them to be happy. Yes.
Thank you for your story. It was very inspiring.
Thank you.
But what are some modifications you maybe had to do at your house, like from an occupational therapy point of view, like maybe put a bar anywhere, or you noticed that your friends did in their house that I could recommend to patients?
Well, it depends on the stage. So I live in a townhouse. Yeah. I make sure that I hold on to the banister going up and down, which I've never done. I've lived there for 30 years, just to make sure I don't fall. Some of the people in my class who were in stage two, their families had made ramps for them. Not that they're in wheelchairs, but it's just smoother for them to come in and come out. You know, if I started getting into stage two, which I may not, I hope I don't, then I would move into an apartment with an elevator in the building. I'd have to. I'd be stupid not to, because for sure I'm going to hurt myself. Yes, sir.
There's growing body of evidence that marijuana can be helpful.
Well, it's interesting you mentioned that. you know, my neurologist is in Fairfield. He only prescribes it to MS patients. The gal I box with, Claire, and about four others who goes through the Yale Hospital Neurology Group, they have cards for CBD, and also marijuana, and it relieves their anxiety. I really don't have any anxiety, but if I did, then it would be something to discuss. But that was an excellent question. Many people who are on have Parkinson's do smoke marijuana. Yes.
Yeah, it also protects those neurons from dying. It's not just for anxiety.
Yes.
So there are constituents in both THC and CBD that will actually are neuroprotective.
Right. And what they do.
In other words, you're getting a suggestion.
Yeah. they go to a special store, a medical store that sells it. They just don't buy it and they're off the street.
Right.
Or in the mail. They get the real stuff.
Sure.
The girl behind you had a question.
I was just curious if you were referred for acupuncture treatment?
Well,
or if that's something you considered when you were...
Yeah, my wife actually went to the acupuncture clinic here and we talked about it. But I really, chiropractic adjustments, it does a trick. You know, I really feel I'm straight and narrow. I come in here and I feel good, and I'm really feeling great. You know, I mean, the chiropractic care is wonderful. You know, I worked on the ambulance. Every time we strained ourselves, they'd send us to occupational therapists, physical therapists. And one day, one of the doctors, because I would always strain myself, they'd say, you know, Andy, my partners would kill me if I told you, you should go to a chiropractor. And I did. I went to Carlton Chiropractic on Main Street in Bridgeport. Until I found out about the UV coming here for my dental cleaning, and they said, "Are you crazy? Why are you paying $75 a visit? You know, here as a senior, it's only $5 a visit. You know, I feel like I'm."